If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life. And I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today. 'Cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the
When Benjamin Franklin exited the Constitutional Convention, he was asked by a woman, "Sir, what have you given us?" His immediate response was, "A republic, ma'am, if you can keep it." Yet most Americans today have been persuaded that our nation's governmental system is a democracy and not a republic. The difference between these two is essential in understanding Americanism and the American system. Before we discuss political systems, however, it's helpful to address the confusion that has been spread about the political spectrum. Many have been led to believe that the political spectrum places groups such as communists on the far left, fascists or dictators on the far right, and political moderates or centrists in the middle. However, a more accurate political spectrum will show government having zero power on the far right to having 100% power on the far left. At the extreme right, there is no government. The extreme left features total government under such labels as communism, socialism, Nazism, fascism, princes, potentates, dictators, kings, any form of total government. Those who claim that Nazis and fascists are right-wing never define their terms. This amounts to spreading confusion. Toward the middle of the political spectrum can be found the type of government limited to its proper role of protecting the rights of the people. That's where the Constitution of the United States is. Those who advocate such a form of government are really constitutional moderates. So let's analyze the basic forms of government. They are monarchy or dictatorship ruled by one, oligarchy ruled by a few, democracy ruled by a majority, republic ruled by law, and anarchy, which is ruled by no one. In discussing these five, we'll see that they can be narrowed down to even fewer. Looking first at monarchy or dictatorship, This form of government doesn't really exist in the practical sense. It's always a group that puts one of its members up front. A king has his council of nobles or earls, and every dictator has his bureaucrats or commissars, the men behind the scenes. This isn't ruled by one, even though one person may be the visible leader. It's ruled by a group. So let's eliminate monarchy, dictatorship, because it never truly exists. Oligarchy, which is ruled by a group, is the most common form of government in all history. And it is the most common form of government today. Most of the nations of the world are ruled by a powerful few, and therefore oligarchy remains. At the other end, we find anarchy, which means without government. Some people have looked over history and found that many of its worst crimes were committed by governments, so they decided that having no government might be a good idea. But this is a mistake, because as the ancient Greeks stated, without law there can be no freedom. Our founding fathers agreed and held that some amount of government is a necessary force in any civilized, orderly society. In a state of anarchy, however, everyone has to guard life, liberty, and property, and the lives of family members. Everyone must be armed, and movement is severely restricted because one's property has to be protected at all times. Civilized people have always hired someone to do the guarding, a sheriff, a police force, or some branch of government. Once law enforcement was in place, the people were freer. They could leave their property, work in the fields, and so on. In short, the proper amount of government makes everyone freer. There are some who advocate anarchy, however, not because they want no government, but because they don't like what they have. They use anarchy as a tool for revolutionary change. The condition of anarchy is very much like a vacuum where something rushes in to fill it. These calculating anarchists work to break down the existing government with rioting, killing, looting, and terrorism. Tragically, the people living in such chaos often go to those best able to put an end to it and beg them to take over and restore order. And who is best able to put an end to the chaos? The very people who started it. The anarchists who created the problem then create a government run by them, an oligarchy, where they have total power. This is exactly what happened in Russia that led to Lenin taking total power, and in Germany, where Hitler's brown shirts created the chaos that brought him to power. But anarchy isn't a stable form of government. It's a quick transition from something that exists to something desired by the power hungry. It's a temporary condition, and because it isn't permanent, we eliminate it as well. The word democracy comes from two Greek words, demos, meaning people, and kratian, meaning to rule. Democracy, therefore, means the rule of the people, majority rule. This, of course, sounds good, but suppose the majority decides to take away one's home, or business, or children. Obviously, there has to be a limit. The flaw in democracy is that the majority isn't restrained. If more than half the people can be persuaded to want something in a democracy, they rule. What about republic? Well, that comes from the Latin, res, meaning thing, and publica, meaning public. It means the public thing, the law. A true republic is one where the government is limited by law, leaving the people alone. America's founders had a clean slate to write on. They could have set up an oligarchy. In fact, there were some who wanted George Washington to be their king. But the founding fathers knew history, and they chose to give us the rule of law in a republic, not the rule of a majority in a democracy. Why? Let's demonstrate the difference in the setting of the Old West. Consider a lynch mob in a democracy. 35 horseback riders chase one lone gunman. They catch him, and they vote 35-1 to hang him. Democracy has triumphed, and there's one less gunman to contend with. Now consider the same scenario in a republic. The 35 horseback riders catch the gunman and vote 35-1 to hang him. But the sheriff arrives, and he says, "You can't kill him. He's got his right to a fair trial." So they take the gunman back to town. A jury of his peers is selected, and they hear the evidence and the defense, and they decide if he shall hang. Does the jury even decide by majority rule? No, it has to be unanimous, or he goes free. The rights of the gunman aren't subject to majority rule, but to the law. This is the essence of a republic. Many Americans would be surprised to learn that the word democracy does not appear in the Declaration of Independence or the U.S. Constitution. Nor does it appear in any of the constitutions of the 50 states. The founders did everything they could to keep us from having a democracy. James Madison, rightly known as the father of the Constitution, wrote in Essay Number 10 of the Federalist Papers, "Democracies have ever been spectacles of turbulence and contention, have ever been found incompatible with personal security or the rights of property, and have in general been as short in their lives as they have been violent in their deaths." Alexander Hamilton agreed, and he stated, "We are a republican government. Real liberty is never found in despotism or in the extremes of democracy." Samuel Adams, a signer of the Declaration of Independence, stated, "Democracy never lasts long. It soon wastes, exhausts, and murders itself." The founders had good reason to look upon democracy with contempt because they knew that the democracies in the early Greek city-states produced some of the wildest excesses of government imaginable. In every case, they ended up with mob rule, then anarchy, and finally tyranny under an oligarchy. During that period in Greece, there was a man named Solon who urged creation of a fixed body of law not subject to majority whims. But where the Greeks never adopted Solon's wise counsel, the Romans did. Based on what they knew of Solon's laws, they created the 12 tables of the Roman law and, in effect, built a republic that limited government power and left the people alone. Since government was limited, the people were free to produce, with the understanding that they could keep the fruits of their labor. In time, Rome became wealthy and the envy of the world. In the midst of plenty, however, the Roman people forgot what freedom entailed. They forgot that the essence of freedom is the proper limitation of government. When government power grows, people freedom recedes. Once the Romans dropped their guard, power-seeking politicians began to exceed the powers granted them in the Roman Constitution. Some learned that they could elect politicians who would use government power to take property from some and give it to others. Agriculture subsidies were introduced, followed by housing and welfare programs. Inevitably, taxes rose and controls over the private sector were imposed. Soon, a number of Rome's producers could no longer make ends meet, and they went on the dole. Productivity declined, shortages developed, and mobs began roaming the streets, demanding bread and circuses from the government. Many were induced to trade freedom for security. Eventually, the whole system came crashing down. They went from a republic to a democracy and ended up with an oligarchy under a progression of the Caesars. Thus, democracy itself is not a stable form of government. Instead, it is the gradual transition from limited government to the unlimited rule of an oligarchy. Knowing this, we as Americans are ultimately left with only two choices. We can keep our republic, as Franklin put it, or we will inevitably end up with an oligarchy, a tyranny of the elite. When Benjamin Franklin exited the Constitutional Convention, he was asked by a woman, "Sir, what have you given us?" His immediate response was, "A republic, ma'am, if..."
We're back. We thought the video was starting over again. Almost. That is a video that should be shown in every high school, middle school in the country to explain to them. But they... You know, I honestly believe the Democrats and the left don't want our kids to know what the actual form of government is that we have and why. Anyways, I thought that'd be a good little reminder. We haven't shown that in a few weeks. Back to what happened in Baton Rouge for the House Speaker. McGez's comments indicate the rift within the House Republican delegation that was exposed in Monday's vote for Speaker left lingering mistrust and frayed nerves among members of the party. At this point, I want to intervene. Our local representatives, Bishop, he got upset with Bernie on Monday in the interview because she kept pushing him about the RIF and why would you do this? And there really was no good reason. He kept trying to say, well, we know that both of them are good men. Bernie wasn't having it. Why did you do this? Barnhart, the big-time lawyer, from my understanding, was calling Republicans. Why? What do the commercials say? He got me $1.6 million. He got me $150,000. He got me this, he got me that. He doesn't want tort reform, guaranteed. But Carol Ross is quite the lady, and she does an awesome job with her show in the afternoon. And she called to talk to Jean-Paul Cousin, and he was very disrespectful. I don't know the whole conversation, but I do know that Carol was not happy. No state representative should be that ugly on the phone, yelling, and I understand, maybe even cursing, at a fine lady who's just trying to do her job and get the information and ask you, why are you doing this? And tell her to lose his phone number and don't call there again. Are you kidding me? You're a state representative. You work for us. And to talk to someone like that and get that ugly when all they simply did was ask you a question? I got no respect at all for people like that. Now that I said that, we'll go back to the other stuff. The Republicans cleaned up in last fall's elections, assumed a historic number of seats, 68, upon being sworn in Monday morning. The party splintered for the first big vote of the term. All 35 of the House Democrats, along with 23 Republicans and two representatives without party affiliation, delivered Sheck Snyder the victory for 60-45. In recent weeks, staff members in Edwards' administration and governor himself called Democratic members, urging them to stick together and vote as a block. The message he was pushing was the Democrats needed to vote together and that they needed to consider who was backing the other candidate. I really don't like who was backing the other candidate. Lane Grigsby, a well-known GOP donor who backed Edwards' opponent Rasponi in last year's governor's race, was backing Mack in the speaker's race. That guy seems to be a jinx to anybody he backs. Also supporting Mack were Attorney General Jeff Landry and U.S. Senator John Kennedy, influential Republicans who frequently spar with Edwards. Landry and Kennedy helped elect many of the House Republicans through the Louisiana Committee for Conservative Majority PAC. And the two used a political action committee during the speaker's race to attack Republicans who wouldn't fall in line behind Mack. Instead, the members attacked the PAC, held firm with Sheck Snyder, and meanwhile, the Democrats met in the basement of the state capitol for several hours, came out of the meeting with a consensus, two Democrats came out publicly for Mack, fell back in line with the party the next day. Sheck Snyder, a Gonzales businessman, said tort reform is a top priority in the next and railed against the outside influences involved in the election and said his election was a testament to the House's independence. It's not true, but anyways, I'm not going to go any deeper into that. This is our moment to restore faith in the people in this state. We will show them the 105 people, men and women from different backgrounds, from different parties, and different parts of the state can be trusted to stand together outside influences and stand for prosperous Louisiana. But Miguez, as well as Republican State Reps Valerie Hodges, who I think a lot of, and a friend, Kathy Edmondson, suggested at the GOP lunch that despite Chuck Snyder's conservative record, his supporters are hostile to conservative causes. Hodges says Chuck Snyder is indebted to the Democrats. What just happened? You know, in elections, sometimes the people that get you there, you have to answer to them. And he got there with 35 Democratic votes, with pretty much all the moderates in the Republican House delegation, Miguez said. Republicans backing Mac knew they didn't have the votes Monday morning. And then there's the headline in the Advocate, surprising victory for John Bel Edwards. Every politician faces an internal struggle between a desire for power and remaining faithful to agenda voters elected them to carry out. Gonzales Republican Clay Sheck Snyder seems to have fallen prey to the tempting delicacy of power. He isn't the first and won't be the last. Sheck Snyder was elected House Speaker this week, but only after cutting a deal with the Democrats, much to the delight of John Bel Edwards. All 35 Democrats and two independents, along with 23 of the 68 Republicans, threw their support behind Sheck Snyder, giving him enough votes to defeat Representative Sherman Mack of Albany. Attorney General Jeff Landry, John Kennedy, most conservatives and business leaders supported Mack. Just watch how this plays out. How the House organizes will play a huge role in which direction the state heads over the next 4 years. During Edwards' first term, he tried over and over to raise taxes. Former Speaker Taylor Barrow, Republican New Iberia, resisted, but eventually was worn down by the media, Democrats, and moderate Republicans to surrender Edwards' call for billions in new taxes. To Barra's credit, he only agreed to half the taxes Edwards demanded. There's a point here where people don't understand. They don't. You see, by doing this and handing that power over, I would say some of the deals that were cut were like for people to be chairman of certain committees, very powerful committees, committees like committees that control gun control. So this speaker gets to assign people to committees. Now, had they gone full-blown as Republicans and stuck together, wouldn't be an issue because most of the committees would be controlled by Republicans. And it's who gets appointed to these committees. See, it wasn't just all the other stuff I just talked about. It's much deeper. This is a real blow to you and me in this state to see this separation after we took the majority in the House, 68-35, and two independents. It's 105 in the House, 39 senators. I don't get it. We have a Democratic governor who now will be able to use his influence to get his way. All because of what? I'm very disappointed in some of our Acadiana House Republicans, especially Cousin and Bishop. Y'all on my list. Y'all say you're gonna do this and do that. I can't trust anything you say anymore. That's me, personally. Why would you do something like this? Totally crazy. The old adage, I have no proof. Follow the money. Follow the money. Bernhardt stuck his nose in there and did some dirty work for Edwards. And you see what these guys are all about is money. Because they want to limit the amount of money you can get people. Well, the Senate picked. Go ahead.
Hello, Jim.
Hey, how's it going, Ray?
Hey, this is Ray. How you doing?
Pretty good.
I'm going to tell you the way I see it. These so-called Republicans are Democrats. I respect Democrats because they say what they are.
Exactly.
These people do not say what they are. They're liars. Democrats, at least, are truthful. But these people are liars, and they are trying to destroy the state with their lies. And I just can't tolerate somebody that's a liar.
Oh, no. I mean, I understand, and I realize that most of those 23... were probably Democrats at one time, and the only way they could get elected is to run as a Republican.
Yeah, they were not Democrats at one time. They're still Democrats.
Exactly.
They just lied about their party affiliation to get elected, and I do not respect them at all.
No, I agree. And
so that's all I have to say tonight.
I appreciate it, Ray. Have a good one.
All right.
Bye-bye. And Ray brings a really good point, and that's what we talk, T and I talk about all the time. And it's the fact that these guys are really Republicans with an R behind their name. But in essence, they're Democrats. And this is a known fact. I learned this a long time ago when I started going to Baton Rouge to committee meetings and stuff. I started learning that some of these people they re-registered as Republicans so they could get elected. But in essence, they vote like Democrats. I agree with Ray. In the aspect of the fact that a Democrat says he's a Democrat. You don't hear that there's Democrats that vote like Republicans. Have you, T? I haven't. They vote like Democrats. And they're honest about what they are. But not that 23. I have no respect for any of them. And I know several of them. It's just amazing how that can be. So now Paige Cortez, at the meeting, this was brought up last week, it's probably was one of the better choices to be the Senate pick for president. Because Paige is right on the edge of a rhino most of the time. In the Senate, State Senate, Republican Senator Paige Cortez, a 58-year-old Lafayette furniture retailer, was unanimously picked as Senate president in a much quieter affair. Cortez succeeds outgoing State Senate President John Alario, who served in the legislature for 48 years. Think about that. Alario was there for 48 years. How's that possible? Well, it's possible because of a rule they have, a law or whatever you want to call it. In other words, when you become term limited in the House, then you can run for the Senate. You become term limited in the Senate, you can turn around and run for your seat in the House again and serve three terms, which I think is ridiculous. Once you're term limited in both, that should be it. Just how I see it. In his speech upon winning, Sheck Snyder railed against outside influences. The 23 Republicans who voted for Sheck Snyder included many who have been willing to work across the aisle, while many conservatives, party leaders, and freshmen sided with Mac. Wow. John Bel Edwards, a Democrat who opted not to nominate a Democratic Speaker candidate after seeing his pick rejected 4 years ago by rejecting partisan rancor and those who seek to turn Baton Rouge into Washington, D.C. We can continue Louisiana's stability and make progress that will allow us to continue. It is really going to be interesting to see what takes place this year. Houma Republican Rep. Tanner McGee, a supporter of Sheck Snyder, won election as Speaker pro tem after no challenger emerged. Despite the pro tem, the number two position in the House was held by Democratic Walt Leger, Edwards' pick for Speaker, who was rejected by the Republican House. In December, Mac won the endorsement of the GOP, and these articles kind of run together. In a much less contentious race to lead the Senate, Cortez was nominated by two earlier rivals for the job, Senators Rick Warren of Port Allen, Ronnie Johns of Sulphur. Ronnie Johns a pretty good guy. It became obvious that one man emerged from our group that convinced enough of the body that he could and should lead us, said John said. They also moved to suspend the Senate rules, thereby allowing nominations and elections to be held publicly. Cortez said after the organizational ceremony that he plans to announce committee assignments in the next week or so, with the priority of the Senate Finance Committee, because Louisiana's Joint Legislative Committee on the Budget is set to meet at the end of the month. Senator Beth Mizell of Franklinton was elected president pro tem, the second highest spot in the Senate leadership. The House and Senate also elected women to key positions in the chamber. The House elected Michelle Fontenot as clerk, and the senators tapped Yolanda Dixon as Senate secretary, the first time either position is held by a woman. Two administrative positions oversee the staffs, advise the elected leadership on rules and traditions. people, it's maddening to me to see what took place here. Just maddening to see what took place. And a lot of this came down because of tort, which I'm going to talk about. It's got some brief stuff on that. I got left for time.
20 minutes.
20 minutes? Okay. This article is about a column that was written by Mark Ballard's opinion piece on proposed tort changes was wrong on the facts and wrong in his conclusion. Ballard failed to present the most important facts. Louisiana policyholders filed twice as many. This is interesting facts. Twice as many bodily injury claims as a national average and claim 67% higher damages than the national average. This is the reason our auto insurance premium are some of the highest in the nation. I can remember years ago, I barely bumped into a person in their car, and GE ended up paying them $10,000. There was no damage to the car, but they got out of the car right away and they were gone. That's the kind of stuff that happens. That's fraud. But why are we more fragile than other Americans? No, does the Louisiana legal system encourage more insurance claims than other states? Yes. The tort reforms in question are all changes to bring Louisiana laws, which are significantly different from other states, into line with the rest of the country. If we want to pay lower premiums like other states, we need laws like the other states. Ballard claims the actuarial report conducted on proposed tort reforms reviewed each point in the omnibus bill and found no cost savings at all. The report analyzed 10 possible reforms. Savings on the various reforms ranged from 0.5% to 5%, but many of the reforms could not be priced because there is no reliable historical experience. The report did not say that there would be no cost savings at all. Ballard points to one statement out of context by an insurance lobbyist that medical, vehicle, and wage costs continue to go up and put upward pressure on automobile premiums as a confession that premiums cannot be reduced. Wrong again. Insurance premiums will continue to go up along with other costs over time, but we can bring Louisiana automobile premiums in line with other states and save Louisiana policyholders significant premium dollars. And it goes on and on in here. Here's the deal. That's another one of those things that keep companies from coming here. I had no clue when I left Wisconsin to take a job here in Louisiana what was going to happen to me when I went to pay my car insurance. Here's an answer. Who will benefit from the so-called tort reform? Approximately 15 years ago, the health insurance company industry stated that the reason Louisiana insurance rates were extremely higher than the rest of the country was because of lawsuits. Then the legislature set the medical malpractice limit to $500,000. Please let me know if this legislation reduced anyone's insurance premiums. An attempt to introduce tort reform legislation will be introduced to supposedly lower insurance premiums. Please pay close attention, who will benefit? That's a big subject, believe me. Oh, gosh. Let me get into this. We were talking about this earlier. Individual focus should be on climate change. T sent me some good articles, and I failed to see and listen to them before, so I have some homework to do. Climate change seems to be so overwhelming that most of us seem incapable of participating in a solution other than pointing a finger at a politician, political party, industry, or some other convenient scapegoat. Having a target for our finger pointing relieves us of responsibility. Instead of pointing fingers, here is a suggestion. Since livestock have a significant effect on air quality, here we go. I plan on not eating meat one day a week and have picked Monday for my participation in Meatless Monday. I would love to learn about other newspaper readers' ideas on what individuals can do to solve this huge problem. If your suggestion is added to mine collectively, we can contribute to the solution. It's by a business coach and licensed counselor in Baton Rouge. You understand that was a joke. I wanted to read this one last week. I have a high school classmate, and I don't know if she watches this show, I doubt it, because she lives in Hawaii and definitely a liberal. But anyways, she drew the ire. She pounded all over Trump. How he's just bad news. So I kept this because this is a good thing for you to tell your friends that this is a list, and I won't go through all of them. It says, this is why we like Trump. About 4 million jobs created. More Americans are now employed than ever recorded in history. We have created more than 400,000 manufacturing jobs. Economic growth last quarter hit 4.2%. New unemployment claims recently hit 49-year low. African American unemployment has recently achieved the lowest rate ever recorded. Hispanic American unemployment is the lowest rate ever. Asian American unemployment recently achieved the lowest rate ever. Women's unemployment recently reached the lowest rate in 65 years. Lowest unemployment rate ever recorded for Americans without a high school diploma. Almost 3.9 million Americans have been lifted off of food stamps since the election. This lady wrote all this stuff down, two pages of the accomplishments of the Trump administration. This one says, that damn Trump. No one has been able to explain to me in common or rational language what it is that our president is doing that is so bad for America, that motivates them to hate him and his supporters. Has he proposed taking away any of our constitutional rights? Have any of our rights disappeared? Has he proposed higher taxes? Has he caused the economy to fail? Has he started any new wars? Oops. On that one. Has he caused the economy to fail? Has he started any new wars? Have minorities suffered more under his leadership than previous? Did he run guns in Mexico? Did he direct the IRS to target leftist nonprofit groups? Did he spy on journalists? No, I think his biggest sin was humiliating the left and those entitlement culture in the last presidential election. These are just some things that I picked up. Let's review the facts, shall we? Cory Booker wants to... Oh, here he comes. Hello?
Yeah, I'm going to try to make it kind of quick. I know there's a lot of people. I know there's some people that's watching it. You know, some liberal Trumpers. I wanted to press you out real quick. About 3 or 4 weeks ago, I'm going to talk fast. About 3 or 4 weeks ago, Obama gave an interview with Politico, and he said that if the Democrats nominate somebody too far to the left, Donald Trump will get reelected. And he's talking about Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren. And the last thing he said was, and I tell you what, I don't agree with it. There's not too much Obama's ever said, but I got to give Obama credit for one thing. I think you're going to agree. When it comes to, you know, politics, Obama is just as good a politician as I've ever seen, and he knows. That's why he tried to talk Biden out of running. And the last thing he said was, after he said about Warren and Sanders couldn't win, Biden doesn't have it either. Okay, Biden doesn't have it. They know it. Last night, I don't watch the debate because I didn't like circuses when I was young. And I still don't like him. But I watched the Post, you know, interview after. And I was watching David Axelrod. Now, this guy's pretty sharp, too. And he's not a flake. I know you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
He ran both Obama's campaign. And I saw Van Jones used to work for Obama. And I'm paraphrasing. Axelrod said, so far, everything that the Democrats are talking about, that is not a winning issue. And Van Jones says, I'm really depressed tonight because, and Bloomberg said this a while back when they got in the race. Van Jones says, there is nobody that I saw tonight on that stage that can beat Donald Trump. And I've been saying that for months, people. I'm telling you, listen close. LD, January the 15th, 2020, come November, Donald Trump will be reelected, okay? And Bloomberg said the same thing, that the only thing that you run against Donald Trump is the economy. You can run against Donald Trump on the economy? And the last comment is, that's why Obama convinced Duval Patrick to get in, which got no shot either.
Yep.
Bottom line is, there's nobody on that stage going to beat Donald Trump. Catch you next week. Thank you,
man. All right, buddy. Thanks. And it's true. I mean, I agree with the fact I haven't seen anything. No one. Everything they talk about, if you really have halfway intelligence of all this free stuff, a 42% federal sales tax. Are you kidding me? 42%. Elizabeth Warren. Hooray. I mean, are you ridiculous?
42%.
Then you got the two.
Local. What is that equal to? About
52%. What is that on? Food, diapers, or the cleanup, the feces cleanup in San Francisco and L.A.? I'm sorry. I can't watch those things because they're so far out. And you don't have to watch them because the next day on Fox, they're going to tell you the whole story, the whole evening, which doesn't amount to much of anything. I was going to read this, but some of it don't apply because certain people dropped out. But and I want to remind people, October, real ID in October. Got something. Nancy Pelosi was in her world today. Some guy, I was watching the signing of the impeachment thing to go across, and somebody said, I hope she trips on the way over there. It's like, don't do that. But another guy said, why does she need so many pens to sign it? She slurred her words. I swear to God. Fail not what to watch ahead of Trump's Senate trial. Nothing. What are the real questions? Oh, here we go. Back to the state stuff. I love this. We're broke, right? We own the Superdome, right? Here we go. Superdome preparing to spring through ramp demolitions by June. Monday night's victory over Clemson wasn't just the culmination of a perfect season for LSU football. And by the way, I meant to do this at the beginning of the show. I got to give a shout out to the UL football team. You guys were awesome this year. 11-3, new school record for victories, won your bowl game, made the people of this parish very proud and this state very proud of you. And to LSU winning the national championship and going 15-0, that's quite an accomplishment. So two of our big state schools, we should really be proud of them for what they accomplished this year. I know. And now I got the academia people out there going, oh, you're talking about sports. But you know what? Those kids got to go to school every day too. And don't go there. I know some of them don't quite take those big, hard courses. But, you know, I probably would have been the same way as it was. But that's a shout out to those people. But here we go again. This just blow you away. The last celebrations of the 42-25 victory may still have been winding down when contractors arrived at the dome on Tuesday. I hope y'all sitting down to begin preparing for the first step in a $450 million multi-year makeover intended to spruce up the stadium in time for the Super Bowl in 2024. $450 million. What benefit do we get? I mean, the Saints get everything. Concessions, tickets. And we give them $25 million a year. They're a professional football team. Why are we giving them money? But we're redoing the Superdome. Well, I guess the upside is if we build a new one, it'd be $1 billion at least to build a new one. And where would you build it? Another little tidbit here. What I got, 2 minutes? I wanted to put this out and this one out, and that'll probably be it for tonight. NSA reports major Windows 10 security fall. Go figure. Security flaw today? The National Security Agency has discovered a major security flaw in Microsoft Windows 10 operating system that could let hackers intercept seemingly secure communications. But rather than exploit the flaw for its own intelligence needs, NSA tipped off Microsoft so that they can fix the system for everyone. Microsoft released a free software patch to fix the flaw Tuesday and credited the intelligence agency for discovering it. Well, aren't they supposed to watch that stuff? No, I guess not. The company said
it's complicated.
Yeah, it's complicated, yeah. The company said it had not seen any evidence that hackers have used the technique. Amit Yoran, CEO of security firm Tenable, said it is exceptionally rare, if not unprecedented, for the deal. And Louisiana's GDP grows 2.9% in the third quarter. And I think that's 30 seconds to go. Look, everybody, stay on top of it. Pray for our city. Pray for our state. Pray for our country. We need all the help we can get. God bless all of you, and be safe out there. And it's time to roll. God bless America. Amen.